for this history display come from the archives, it's called now, it used to be called the Long Island Division, the Central Library. And the information and the articles that are here come from microfilm from the Ridgewood Times over the years. So the history starts in 1901. There were less than 2,000 people in Greater Ridgewood. It was mostly farms. Now when I say Greater Ridgewood at this time, it included, Ridgewood was in Queens and also in Brooklyn, which is now Bushwick. So Greater Ridgewood, as I'm speaking, is about Brooklyn and Queens together, which was called Ridgewood. But 10 years later, in 1911, the population had grown significantly. Up to 1910, the only public library in the area was in the Brooklyn section of Greater Ridgewood at Knickerbocker and Grove Street. There were no libraries in the Queens section. So because of the population explosion, in July of 1910, the Queens Library opened two traveling stations in the Ridgewood section of, in the Queens section of Ridgewood. And a traveling station meant that a business person would donate part of their office or a room, so that the library could set up shelves and have books and have a desk for a librarian, and then people could come and borrow materials and bring them back, but there really wasn't a place to sit and read there. And in this, here is a picture here of a traveling, the traveling library station was set up in Eminer's real estate, so he was the businessman who donated his office space, in the Evergreen section on July 20th, 1910. And that was one of the two traveling stations. The other one was set up on 504 Woodward Avenue near Green Avenue in the office generously donated by Herman Golinghurst. Okay. Then in some facts, in 1910 and 1911, an average of 4,366 books were borrowed monthly from the Ridgewood Station. And in January of 1910, a record of 6,354 books were circulated, the highest in the Queens system at that time. Today, Ridgewood circulates about 23,000 materials a month. So because of this high circulation, the library board discontinued the traveling station. Oh, I'm sorry, before I get to that. This map over here and shows you the traveling stations, and the dots show you where they are on the map. Okay. But because the circulation was so high, the library board discontinued the traveling stations and opened a regular library branch for Ridgewood on March 18, 1911, at the corner of Green Avenue and Seneca Avenue in a store. And that's what this picture is right here. There's children in front of the newly chartered Ridgewood Branch Library of the Queensboro Public Library on the corner of Green Avenue and Seneca Avenue. It's 501 Seneca. And I actually went over there because there were a couple of different storefronts that were mentioned to look and see if that was the one. And there's a deli here now, so you really can't see the store and you can't see that, but the architectural features of the building are still there. So it's definitely that building. The gate is still there. And this cornice is not here, but there's one just like it over there. So it's definitely the first one, 1911, 501 Seneca Avenue, the corner of Green Avenue. And it was started with a collection of 2,000 books. But it was too small to accommodate the people who wanted to use it, especially the children. So in May of 1912, the Ridgewood Library was moved to double the space at the corner of Underdunk Avenue and Harmon Street with a separate room for children. More chairs, tables were added, and framed photographs of great paintings were placed on the walls. And again in 1912, the Ridgewood Library moved to two rented stores at Seneca Avenue near Woodbine Street, where it remained until 1929. And there's just an article here from that time that says, "A doll story hour will be held in the Ridgewood branch of the Queensboro Public Library, Seneca Avenue near Woodbine Street, on Wednesday morning, December 26th at 10 o'clock. All little girls who wish to come are invited to bring their dollies with them." So they had children's programs even back in 1912 in the storefronts. In 1917, the Ridgewood Library had the highest circulation once again in the Queens system. And in 1917, They also opened a Grandview Branch Library at the intersection of Gates, Grandview, and Forest Avenues. I think there's Korean Square is there now, so that's where another library was. And there were also two traveling stations, one in Glendale and one in Middle Village. You can see that on that map. And this map shows the different storefronts, where it moved at various times, the storefronts, the library, and the red dot is where we are today. A little trivia from 1925. A January 1925 Ridgewood Times article informed library patrons of barrel days, a new Queensborough Public Library policy. Overdue books could be returned without imposition of a fine on certain designated days. A barrel was placed at the library entrance for deposit of all overdue books. This policy was established because inventories had showed great losses. And now, as of 1925, the fines for daily fines for overdue books were 2 cents per day. And they also, there were stipulations as to what you could borrow. Every adult member may take 5 books only, 3 of which may be fiction, and only 1 of the 3 fiction may be a 7-day book. Today, the fines are for children daily 10 cents for books, and $1 for DVDs, and adult books are 25 cents. For books and $3 for DVDs, and cardholders can borrow 50 items. But the demand for books increased, and the Ridgewood Times, and other community groups agitated and petitioned for a true library building for Ridgewood. Roland E. Benneville, who was the executive secretary of the Ridgewood Chamber of Commerce, became the secretary of the newly formed Ridgewood Citizens Library Committee and worked tirelessly to accomplish this goal. In 1921, the committee presented Mayor Hyland and then Board of Aldermen head Fiorello LaGuardia with a 15-point request for an adequate library building in Ridgewood. The Board of Aldermen is equivalent to today's City Council. And shortly after that, a 40,000 signature petition was also sent to the mayor and to the Board of Aldermen. And the pressure worked. And in the late 1920s, there was discussion before the Board of Estimate and Apportionments to appropriate $35,000 to buy a site for the Ridgewood Library and $75,000 to construct a building, but it ended up costing $105,000. Plans for the building were drawn by Henry C. Brooker, a Ridgewood architect, who had his offices on Cypress Hill Street and Central Avenue. That's the triangle that Stop and Shop is on. Mm-hmm. It's the pointy part where Central Avenue and Cypress Hill Street meet. And there used to be 5 two-family homes along there that were demolished about 10 years ago, and his office was in one of those buildings. Oh. According to Leora Jenkins, a librarian, the site at Forest and Madison was chosen to make a little cultural area. Across Forest Avenue, there existed a lyceum where cultural events, lectures, debates, and public meetings were held. And across Madison Street, there was an elementary school, which is now a junior high, 93. The Ridgewood Library was going to be the first library built in Queens with municipal funds, that is, city funds. The other 5 branches already built in Queens were erected with Carnegie funds, and that meant that the city paid for the site and the annual maintenance, the salaries, and the books, but the Carnegie funds paid for the building's construction both inside and out. Because Ridgewood was going to be the first library built with all city funds, the trustees of the Queensborough Public Library wanted to make it a model branch library. But nothing runs smoothly. So in 1926, there was a problem with the allocated monies for the Ridgewood Library building, since there were no contracts yet signed for its construction. The Board of Estimate voted to rescind the allocation. However, there was a protest by the Ridgewood Times and the Ridgewood Metropolitan Civic Association stating that since the $1,500,000 allocated for a Brooklyn library had not been rescinded, then the $75,000 for a Ridgewood Library in Queens should not be rescinded. And they won. The library building was started in 1928, and if you go out to the patio, there's a, on the building, there's the cornerstone, and it says 1928 is the year it has on it. So that's when the building was started. In February 1929, with the library building nearing completion, the Ridgewood Chamber of Commerce petitioned the Board of Estimate and Apportionment to appropriate $50,000 in order to properly equip and staff the library. And when the Ridgewood Library Building opened in 1929, the two storefront branches, Grandview Branch on Forest Gates and Grandview, and the Ridgewood Branch on Seneca and Woodbine were closed. And this is the building that was built. Here it is. It's symmetrical. There are two windows, and there was an outside staircase. After the Ridgewood Library was built, the community agitated for a branch to be built to serve the Glendale community. And that happens eventually. Now I've got a phone. Okay. A year, 1930, in October 1930, there was a little report about the Ridgewood Library, and it says the adult circulation and adult reference work is done on the first floor, which is where it is today, and with a separate children's library downstairs. And the children's library has a separate entrance leading to Forest Avenue. So I would assume the children came in this way, like through this entrance, Forest Avenue. Also in that Ridgewood Times article, it says that if a person wants a book and it's not in the Ridgewood Library, but it's held in another library in Queens, they can request that the other library to send the book to Ridgewood and they could borrow it, which is a service that's still in place today. But the library became so busy and utilized that by 1936, as part of a WPA project, the building was expanded to Fairview Avenue. And we have quite a few pictures of that. Here's the expansion. You can see there's the original library, two windows, and then they added on three more windows to expand it. The staircase was also taken away, and it was an inside staircase built. And the children's entrance, because the children's room was downstairs, the children's entrance was underneath on the two sides of the staircase. And this is a picture of the children's room at that time. I believe you came in this way through from the staircase. And this is another look at it. And the boards here with the green show more pictures of the adult room upstairs. The only interruption of library service, other than for renovating, came during World War II. Due to fuel shortages, most libraries had curtailed hours, and the Ridgewood Library was closed as of February 23, 1943, until a delivery of oil was received. I don't know when the oil finally came. The library stayed the same until 1963, when it was once again renovated, but this time downsized. The children's room was moved upstairs to the first floor, taking over one-third of the adult area. And the children's area, which had been the children's library downstairs, became a storage area for all of Queen's Library's extra furniture, shelving, snowblowers, and whatever. And the stairs also, this was closed off, and the stairs were moved to the outside on the side of the building on Madison Street. In the 1970s, the city of New York suffered a severe budget crisis. Library funding was cut, causing the library to cut jobs and hours. The Ridgewood branch was open only 3 days a week. So in 1992, the Friends of the Ridgewood Library was chartered by the Queen's Library to be advocates to elected officials for return to six-day service funding. Doesn't that sound familiar? The Queen's Library campaign worked, and the library was back to normal service hours. But the Ridgewood Library on only one floor was cramped and circulation was increasing. There was little space to sit and read and less space for a quiet area. So once again, as in the 1920s, a group of concerned citizens started to advocate and petition for a better and larger library. In the 20s, it had been the Ridgewood Citizens Library Committee, and in the 1990s, it was the Friends of the Ridgewood Library and the Ridgewood Property Owners and Civic Association. For the next 10 years, the Friends spoke at community board meetings, testified at City Council and Queensboro President budget hearings, and constantly reminded the Queens Library's administrators about the need for an expanded Ridgewood Library. Finally, in May of 2006, that dream was realized. The Ridgewood Library moved, the children's room is down, is on the first floor level. There's an elevator for easy access. And there's an expanded meeting room, which we have now. And in 2011, the last step of the renovation was realized with the reopening of the adult and new teen areas on the first floor and the beautiful patio and garden. And in January of 2014, the outdoor uplighting was completed to spotlight the Ridgewood Library as a beacon on the Ridgewood scene. So that's the history. I brought you up to date. If you want to see how it looks now, you'd have to walk around the library. I just want to explain to you the boards are sort of color coordinated. The blue is the early times, the traveling stations and the storefronts. Then the pink is when it opened this library in 1929, which we are celebrating today. And then the green is the expansion in 36, 37, and a little purple over here. And then the yellow shows what happened from 63 to 2006. And I would just like to talk about the Long Island Division, the archives. If anyone here is interested in any kind of history of Queens or Brooklyn, the Long Island Division at the Central Library in Jamaica is a wonderful resource. They have a database of pictures, they have books, they have maps, and they have microfilm. Thank you. They have the newspapers on microfilm, which is what I went through with the Ridgewood Times, but they have other community newspapers. So it's a wonderful, wonderful place to go. You can't borrow books from it, but you can sit there and browse, and if there's anything that you want, you can have them. They make a copy for you for 15 cents, I think it costs. So it's a wonderful place for history. Are there any questions? Okay. Thank you. Oh.